So Kevin DeYoung and I are here to talk to you about the preamble and the 12 statements. And let me just start by saying, Kevin and I first talked about working together on this committee after we'd been assigned to it. And we were actually together in a Chicago airport, if you remember. Mm-hmm. And we know that even though, as we're going to say here in a second, that even though it's called the Ad Interim Committee on Human Sexuality, that the General Assembly was not asking us to write a whole paper on human sexuality in general, but on the particular issues that are rising right now in the evangelical world, let's say, over homosexuality, transgenderism, and especially issues that have come up around the Revoice conferences. So we talked about this a little bit, and we do know that there's a certain image that Kevin and I are at opposite ends of various theological spectrums. And to our surprise, as we sat and informally talked about, well, what do you think about this issue, this issue, this issue, we found very little major difference on that. And obviously we have different temperaments, we're different generations. And so obviously we would probably, if we were writing our own statements, the statements would be a bit different. But what we ended up doing was working together for a original set of statements. I think there were like eight in the beginning. Mm-hmm. And then after that, the committee worked through those statements, and we've decided that we wanted to be able as a committee to sign off on virtually every sentence in those 12 statements. And Kevin was the receptacle of all that. So Kevin, in the end, ended up doing the most work on the 12 statements. I think it's fair to say that without saying that it was his authorship, because he was the one that we kept every time we got together, since we wanted to agree on everything. He was the one that was like the secretary. He brought it in there. And I would say the footnotes, definitely all those wonderful footnotes in which Kevin was making sure that everything we said was grounded either in the scripture or the confession. Kevin did a tremendous amount of work. So I can brag on that. I don't think he would say that when he's on camera.
Wouldn't say that. Let me just say, Tim, yeah. That's very kind. And that's, it was a joy to have the two of us. We've known each other for a number of years, and our time is short here, so we don't want to just go back and forth. But there's hardly anybody in the PCA who's gone out of his way more to be an encouragement and a kind-hearted, I don't know, older brother, father figure than Tim has. So thank you, Tim. And we're all praying for you, of course, and your health, and thanks. Good to see you. Your hair is not even as gray as mine. How is this possible?
It's because there's so little of it.
Yeah. That's so right. Brian led the committee really well.
Oh, yes.
Very well organized, kept us on track. It was really fair through the whole process, just wanted to get us to a good conclusion. And by God's grace, I think we got there. And you and I are going to talk just a little bit and mostly take our time to read through the preamble and the 12 statements, which is, I think we can say, kind of a canon within a canon for the report. All of it's important. Everyone worked really hard on various aspects of it. We really went through with a fine-tooth comb the preamble and especially the 12 statements to make sure that we said it the way we wanted to say it. So we're not going to do too much theological ad-libbing because we need to speak for the breadth of the committee, but having at least put in the work on the first initial drafts of these two sections, we're going to read through them and give just a little bit of commentary back and forth.
Yes. So let me read the preamble, even though I will be brief. I'm going to try to make this in 5 minutes. I don't have much to say about it. The preamble was also something that everybody on the committee sign off on word for word and sentence for sentence. So let me read it, and I'll just have very little to say about it because I want to get into the 12 statements. But the preamble goes like this. This committee was tasked by the 2019 General Assembly to study the topic of human sexuality with particular attention to the issues of homosexuality, same-sex attraction, and transgenderism, and prepare a report. Now, those are words from Overture 42 from Chicago Metro Presbytery, as amended by the 47th General Assembly. Our task was not to address the whole of human sexuality, but limited to specific concerns raised in our denominations, to wit, the Assembly's adopted a mature list of a number of issues that it wanted the report to address, including one, the nature of sexual sin, temptation, and mortification; two, the propriety or not of a Christian referring to himself or herself as a gay Christian, quote unquote; three, the propriety or not of speaking of a homosexual, quote unquote, orientation; and four, recent practices of incorporating Christians into Christian community who have been attracted to the same sex, all while giving special attention to parts of the scripture, for example, 1 Corinthians 6 and the standards, for example, Westminster Larger Catechism 138 and 139, that are relevant to these topics. Our list of assigned topics then is long, and we have sought to address them most directly in this preamble and the immediately following 12 statements that we pray are of a length to be most helpful for ease of distribution and common use in the church. This preamble and 12 statements are a summary of our discussions and convictions and provide a theological and pastoral framework for all the other parts of the report. Our committee engaged in its most lengthy and precise discussions on these two documents, the preamble and the 12 statements, as we carefully weighed the most critical issues to provide biblical and confessional arguments that we hope will bring clarity and unity on these sensitive subjects for our churches, families, and friends. Our committee also gathered explanatory essays from our members that discuss issues assigned to us by the Assembly. We have included these essays in subsequent sections of this report because without endorsing how every thought is expressed, we all believe that they will be helpful in explaining key understandings behind the 12 statements. Here's my only break at this point, is just very important to see that the seven members of the committee signed off on every phrase and statement in the 12 statements and the preamble, but we various members assembled reports that we agree with in principle, but we didn't go through. Not everybody agrees with absolutely every statement in those other reports or every bit of wording in the other reports. That wouldn't have been necessary, we didn't think. So we would like the Assembly to give most special attention to these first two documents. Now, finally, we compiled a select annotated bibliography that lists materials we believe will be helpful to the various constituencies of our church who wish to become more informed about these issues. Now, in this bibliography, we have provided materials for a variety of audiences, pastors, scholars, parents, children, etc. Our goal was not to present an exhaustive list of all available materials, which would unbalance the elements and efficacy of this report, but to aid the church by presenting some of the most useful materials for different constituencies and different purposes. And again, we need to say, quote, we cannot affirm our agreement with every word or thought in such a wide variety of materials. Indeed, sometimes we must make informed readers aware of resources they should be prepared to counter or receive with caution. In other words, there are some things that we would like you to read just because you need to actually counter them. So we're not endorsing everything that's said in every one of these items in the bibliography. Our goal is for our annotations then to guide our readers with biblical discernment needed to hold to what is good and rightly sift what is unbiblical or less certain. And amidst all these statements, there are two overarching concerns. The two tasks could be called the pastoral task and the apologetic task. On the one hand, Overture 42 asks that the report help pastors and sessions shepherd congregants who are dealing with same-sex attraction. On the other hand, it asks for suggested ways to articulate and defend a biblical understanding of homosexuality, same-sex attraction, and transgenderism in the context of a culture that denies that understanding. Both of those are from the motion that was adopted by the 47th General Assembly, both shepherd congregants and defend the biblical position. There's no reason why these two tasks need to be pitted against each other, although they often seem to be. One reason they seem at loggerheads is that attached to each undertaking is a set of fears. One set of fears is that we will be harsh and unfeeling toward people who have been wounded and deeply hurt very often by the church. A hard-sounding stance toward them at this moment may only make it easier to discredit the church in people's minds. As a consequence, many are afraid that the church will speak in ways that only support the powerful cultural narrative that Orthodox Christian belief is toxic for hurting and struggling people. But the other set of fears is that we'll compromise at the very place where the world is attacking the church and our culture. We see many professing Christians and whole denominations surrendering to the sexual revolution. We do not want to be one of them, nor even now in subtle ways to sow the seeds for some future capitulation As a natural family is a fundamental unit of human society and is the normal means of care and nurture, all sins that threaten, undermine, or marginalize the family are both spiritually dangerous and detrimental to human flourishing in general. Part of the problem with regard to addressing these issues is that many of us are far more gripped by one set of fears than the other, not because, but because both of these tasks were given to us, the pastoral task and the apologetic, we need to give both of them strong attention. We try to do that in this report. Sinclair Ferguson in his book, I'm not sure I'm going to read all the rest of this, but Sinclair Ferguson points out that legalism and antinomianism, and in a certain sense, the apologetic task, if you're too afraid of compromising truth, you can get into a form of legalism. But if you're too afraid of hurting the pastoral task, you can kind of get into antinomianism. You can say, well, let's not come down on these folks. So one is like speaking the truth without love. One is trying to love without speaking the truth. And Sinclair says that legalism and antinomianism are always the twin problems. However, you should never think that the best way to overcome legalism is with a dose of antinomianism, or the best way to overcome antinomianism is a dose of legalism. And we need to not do that. We need to speak the truth in love. And what we try to do in the 12 statements is actually just finish, as you will see, we would say this, and then on the other hand, this. And generally speaking, not always, by the way, but in most of the 12 statements, the first part is more the truth. The second part is more the pastoral way to administer that truth. And we try to do both in every statement, though actually one of the statements is the reverse, actually, if I remember correctly. So let me just finish this way. The very form of the following 12 statements, which is trying to capture grace and truth, is not trying to find a balance or a third way. Even though Tim Keller was part of it, we weren't trying to find a third way. Kevin, by the way, doesn't particularly like that aspect of
mine. Well, I was going to say that Tim and I are always joking because Tim has a genius for finding the third way, golden mean. And right. Then I'm always the anti-third way. But I was going to say, I love the way that this preamble puts it. And I think, Tim, you are the one who first came up with the language of a set of fears. So it's not clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right. Here I am stuck in the middle with you. We're not just trying to find this golden mean, but it is to acknowledge what's a fact. And when we come to these controversial issues, because of our experience, because of our background, all sorts of issues, we have a set of fears that we bring to it. We kind of, okay, we all know this, but are you really going to say this? And what we try to articulate there in the preamble is we understand there are two sets of fears, probably more than that, but at least two, and they're understandable fears. And we're not trying to just give a little here, take a little here, and we'll just get a perfect potion in the middle. But if we can set out understanding, we want to try to address different sorts of fears in this document, I think will be most helpful. So I didn't mean to cut you off for you.
No. I would say I'm done because we were tasked to be both how do you shepherd people and how do you defend the biblical position. And so we're not trying to find a golden mean or a middle ground or a third way, but we wanted to say here's the theology and here's the way we think we should be administering pastorally the theology. And that was our way of kind of moving through it in that way. No, I'm done, but I will say that the two narratives out there that the younger people, especially, I'm afraid, are believing. One is that the church is a toxic place and it just is harsh to people and it's not kind and caring. The other is that you've got to be an authentic person, you've got to express your sexual desires. And what we want to counter both of them. And if we're just harsh, we will not counter both of them. But if we give in to in any way, if we capitulate in any way to the sexual revolution, we are also essentially not countering them. So it's not that easy to counter both of them, but we try to do that in this report. So Kevin, you need to turn to the 12 statements.
All right. So there's a few things about the 12 statements and I'll read through them. I know it can be tedious to have someone read to you. I won't read the footnotes. Though, as Tim alluded to, I think a lot of our most important work is in the footnotes. One of the great things about being Presbyterians and being a part of the Reformed tradition even though our, you know, our theological forefathers weren't addressing the particular issue of revoice or same-sex attraction, the root issues, they were. I mean, these things map on to anthropology, our doctrine of sin, even our doctrine of Christ, our doctrine of sanctification. So we have these great resources, most importantly, obviously, the inerrant word, but also our standards, and then the Reformed tradition and all of these smart people that we're quoting down here in the footnotes who help us say, okay, how do we take the best of Reformed thinking on these core issues, and then how does it map onto this contemporary controversy? So statement one, marriage. We affirm that marriage is to be between one man and one woman. And I'm not going to read all the parenthetical citations either. Sexual intimacy is a gift from God to be cherished and is reserved for the marriage relationship between one man and one woman. Marriage was instituted by God for the mutual help and blessing of husband and wife, for procreation and the raising together of godly children, and to prevent sexual immorality. Marriage is also a God-ordained picture of the differentiated relationship between Christ and the church. All other forms of sexual intimacy, including all forms of lust and same-sex sexual activity of any kind, are sinful. Nevertheless, we do not believe that sexual intimacy in marriage automatically eliminates unwanted sexual desires, nor that all sex within marriage is sinless. We all stand in need of God's grace for sexual sin and temptation, whether married or not. Moreover, sexual immorality is not an unpardonable sin. There is no sin so small it does not deserve damnation, and no sin so big it cannot be forgiven. There is hope and forgiveness for all who repent of their sin and put their trust in Christ. So as Tim said, we didn't go what a lot of statements do, affirmations and denials, that would have been fine, but affirmations and neverthelesses. And it's important to say, these don't stand in tension. It's not like, well, you have truth on one side and you have pastoral care on the other side. No, any pastoral care worth its name must be rooted in truth. And any real pursuit and care for the truth must be, you must endeavor to apply it in a way that people can receive it pastorally. And so these go together in each of these pairs, affirming here are the doctrinal truths. And then the nevertheless is, okay, what are the guardrails? Where might people be nervous about the truth we just affirmed, so that they're applied in ways that people hear what we're saying? We're trying to make not the truth palatable, but we're trying to make it clear, and so that people receive what we're actually saying and don't hear what we're not saying. So I'll just keep going, Tim, and you stop after any of these. I'll pause and you can say something as well.
I'm not going to say much after the next few statements, but I wanted to say this first statement is really fundamental to everything else. It's really, I'm very, very pleased with it. But notice what it says is marriage is a God-ordained picture of the differentiated relationship between Christ and the church. In other words, if sex doesn't reflect the relationship between Christ and the church in three ways, the relationship between Christ and the church is covenantal. So any non-covenantal sex outside of marriage is wrong. Secondly, notice the word differentiation. Mm-hmm. Is that our union brings together the divine and the human. And so any sexuality that doesn't represent that bringing together of difference in a covenant, in other words, is sex outside of marriage between a man and a woman. And then lastly, the inference, of course, is that new life comes out of the union between Christ and the church, that we get new life, and then through us, other people get new life. And so the idea is that non-covenantal sex, non-differentiated sex, and sex that's not able to produce new life, that's the kind of both, that's the Christian theology of marriage. And sex outside of covenant between a man and a woman that at least is capable of producing, we would not say that every human marriage has got to produce children. There are many ways in a fallen world in which that may not happen. But the fact is that this first statement, in a way, everything else that we say comes from this one. So I'm not going to say anything for the next few, but I just wanted you to know that almost everything else we say is an inference from this first statement on marriage. So
yeah, and it's probably worth just remembering
how unique and what a blessing it is that the PCA, I think I can say across the board, agrees with this statement.
Right.
I mean, there are whole, I mean, there are all sorts of denominations that have been torn asunder and have capitulated on these things, which where I think virtually everyone, maybe everyone in the PCA would read this first statement and say, well, yeah, of course, we all agree on that.
Right.
And so let's not minimize agreeing on this is a major spirit wrought achievement yes. in our culture. Statement two, image of God. We affirm that God created human beings in his image as male and female. Likewise, we recognize the goodness of the human body, the call to glorify God with our bodies. As a God of order and design, God opposes the confusion of man as woman and woman as man. While situations involving such confusion can be heartbreaking and complex, men and women should be helped to live in accordance with their biological sex. Nevertheless, we ought to minister compassionately to those who are sincerely confused and disturbed by their internal sense of gender identity. We recognize that the effects of the fall extend to the corruption of our whole nature, which may include how we think of our own gender and sexuality. Moreover, some persons in rare instances may possess an objective medical condition in which their anatomical development may be ambiguous or does not match their genetic chromosomal sex. Such persons are also made in the image of God and should live out their biological sex insofar as it can be known. So our main task was not to address transgender issues, but this we felt like we needed to, and that was part of the task. And so we try to address that here. And you just notice at the end of that statement, the language of an objective medical condition. So we're differentiating. We didn't want to get far down the track of intersex and some of the very rare, but you know, significant conditions. But there we're talking about objective medical conditions, which render some ambiguity rather than just an internal sense of my own identity being something than what the chromosomal biological sex indicates. Statement three, original sin. We affirm that from the sin of our first parents, we have received an inherited guilt and an inherited depravity. From this original corruption, which is itself sinful and for which we are culpable. So we have inherited original corruption and original guilt from Adam, proceed all actual transgressions, all the outworkings of our corrupted nature, a corruption which remains in part even after regeneration, are truly and properly called sin. Every sin, original and actual, deserves death and renders us liable to the wrath of God. We must repent of our sin in general, and our particular sins particularly. That is, we ought to grieve for our sin, hate our sin, turn from our sin unto God, and endeavor to walk with God in obedience to his commandments. Nevertheless, God does not wish for believers to live in perpetual misery for their sins, each of which are pardoned and mortified in Christ. By the Spirit of Christ, we are able to make spiritual progress and do good works, not perfectly, but truly. Even our imperfect works are made acceptable through Christ, and God is pleased to accept and reward them as pleasing in his sight. So there's a lot of important work down in the footnotes explaining actual sin distinguished from original sin, actual sin, what we carry out in an act of the soul is the technical language. So not actual in the sense of, well, you know, it's you got fake sins and actual sins. And then Turretin's distinction there between works which are perfectly good, we can't do those, but we can do what are truly good. And so there is hope, and we're going to see this balance throughout, that there is real gospel hope for transformed lives, for the mortification of the flesh, for the vivification of the spirit. And we want to accent that hope in the transforming power of the spirit, and at the same time acknowledging that we are going to have the remnants of indwelling sin until we get to glory. Statement four, desire. We affirm not only that our inclination towards sin is a result of the fall, but that our fallen desires are in themselves sinful. The desire for an illicit end, whether in sexual desire for a person of the same sex or in sexual desire disconnected from the context of biblical marriage, is itself an illicit desire. Therefore, the experience of same-sex attraction is not morally neutral. The attraction is an expression of original or indwelling sin that must be repented of and put to death. Nevertheless, we must celebrate that despite the continuing presence of sinful desires and even at times egregious sinful behavior, Repentant, justified, and adopted believers are free from condemnation to the imputed righteousness of Christ and are able to please God by walking in the Spirit. Let's read this next statement. And then, oh, you want to say something here, Tim, before we do concupiscence?
No, do concupiscence. They go pretty
close. They go together.
Very much together.
We affirm that impure thoughts and desires arising in us prior to and apart from a conscious act of the will are still sin. We reject the Roman Catholic understanding of concupiscence, whereby disordered desires that afflict us due to the fall do not become sin without a consenting act of the will. These desires within us are not mere weaknesses or inclinations to sin, but are themselves idolatrous and sinful. Nevertheless, we recognize that many persons who experience same-sex attraction describe their desires as arising in them unbidden and unwanted. We also recognize that the presence of same-sex attraction is often owing to many factors, which always include our own sin nature and may include being sinned against in the past. As with any sinful pattern or propensity, which may include disordered desires, extramarital lust, pornographic addictions, and all abusive sexual behavior, the actions of others, though never finally determinative, can be significant and influential. This should move us to compassion and understanding. Moreover, it is true for all of us that sin can be both unchosen bondage and idolatrous rebellion at the same time. We all experience sin at times as a kind of voluntary servitude. There's a lot there, and really yes. Maybe these two sections are a lot of the heavy theological lifting. We could say a lot, but Tim, just give a comment or two.
Yeah, well, on concupiscence, I think what Kevin just read there, for a good example is to say that a sexual desire for what the Bible considers an illicit object isn't wrong. That we can't go there. The Bible says if it's wrong to do it, it's wrong to want to do it. That's actually almost common sense, but it's also biblical and confessional. And yet you want to say, well, what about a child, for example, who was abused by a male adult and who later on finds that this child, as he grows up, finds that his own sexual desires have been distorted by that. Shouldn't that elicit some sympathy? You know, some pastoral sympathy. That's all we're saying. We're not saying here, no sympathy. It's just, well, yes. I mean, a lot of times our desires are distorted not by us just giving into them, but because they were in some ways brought in because we're social as well as individual creatures. We have our own will, but we also are sinned against. David Pallison used to always talk about the fact that your desire is a result of sin, but it's not just always your sin. It's also other people sinning against you. And we're just simply saying, yes, tell the truth, but show some sympathy. The other thing about desire, I like the fact that we said, I forget who came up with it, it wasn't me, that to desire a person of the same sex or to desire a person who's not your spouse, let's say you're married, a sexual desire for a person not your spouse, one of those is a homosexual desire, one of those is a heterosexual desire. What this is trying to say is they're both wrong, and you've got to be very careful not to try to create a moral hierarchy. If I was perfectly sanctified, I would have no ability to even desire a woman, sexually desire a woman other than my spouse. But the fact is, because we're not perfectly sanctified, all heterosexual men who are married have that ability to desire that, and that is illicit. And we have to be very careful not to say, well, to desire a man is unnatural, to desire a woman is natural. So one of those is a more sinful desire than the other. This text is actually saying no, that basically they're both equally illicit. They're both equally wrong. The capacity for sin is still wrong. It's the original sin is what's wrong with us. And I think that's very important that we don't create a little hierarchy inside. And those were two things that I thought were really important in the statements. Anything you want to add?
I'm just going to go back. I was going to mention David Pollison too, and it's the whole CCEF has been really good to remind us that everyone you encounter, and including ourselves, we're sinners and sufferers.
Yeah.
And it's not, you know, an equal measure. It's not all 50-50. Right. But here, I'm going to do the Tim Keller third way thing, because our culture says you can be one or the other. And if you're one, you're not the other. So we don't want to fall in the ditch that says, okay, if you're a sinner, all I can see in you is sin. And we don't want to approach this issue yeah, you had some bad stuff happen, but let's talk about the sin and forget that the sin, though yours, may have been, at least in some consequence, the result of suffering. So we're sinners and sufferers. And then on the other hand, there is a certain cultural narrative that says, well, if you're a sufferer, then how dare you talk about any sin? You're only a victim. You're only a sufferer. People have oppressed you in some way. They've hurt you in some way. And so you can't be responsible for your sin. And the best of Reformed theology, and it's drawing from the Bible, says, well, no, you do have compassion toward people that say you know, in a cosmic sense, it looks to us like you were given a raw hand, a raw deal, or at least a worse hand in life than I was given or Tim Keller was given. So of course, especially as Christians, you want to have sympathy and compassion. And at the same time, that compassion for the way in which people may uniquely suffer or have been sinned against does not remove the responsibility and the culpability of our own sin. And that's the pastoral task to hold both of those. All right, we'll speed through statement 6, temptation. We affirm that scripture speaks of temptation in different ways. There are some temptations God gives us in the form of morally neutral trials, and other temptations God never gives us because they arise from within as morally illicit desires. You actually see the footnote there. Same Greek word used as in James 1, important text, trials or temptations. So there are certain temptations that are really trials of suffering, and then there are others that are not morally neutral. When temptations come from without, the temptation itself is not sin unless we enter into the temptation. But when the temptation arises from within, it is our own act and is rightly called sin. Nevertheless, there is an important degree of moral difference between temptation to sin and giving into sin, even when the temptation is itself an expression of indwelling sin. While our goal is the weakening and lessening of internal temptations to sin, Christians should feel their greatest responsibility, not for the fact that such temptations occur, but for thoroughly and immediately fleeing and resisting the temptations when they arise. We can avoid entering into temptation by refusing to internally ponder and entertain the proposal and desire to actual sin. Without some distinction between one, the illicit temptations that arise in us due to original sin, and two, the willful giving over to actual sin, Christians will be too discouraged to make every effort at growth in godliness and will feel like failures in their necessary efforts to be holy as God is holy. God is pleased with our sincere obedience, even though it may be accompanied with many weaknesses and imperfections. So I remember, Tim, you were drawing from Owen and trying to get some of these important distinctions about entering in. I think we really talked about the right language here. And so we came up with a moral difference. So it's not saying that these temptations for illicit desires are not in themselves sin. They are, and that's important. And yet we don't want to just leave people there. Well, it's all sin. There's no degree of difference all across the board.
Right.
So you fight that temptation, even if at that level of temptation, it's an expression of sin. You fight that. And there is, it is pleasing to God.
Right.
When we don't allow those expressions of original sin to grow into actual sin and progress along the lines of James chapter 1.
Yeah, I mean, not to elongate, but John Owen, both Kevin and I have tremendous respect for Owen's work on mortification, on temptation. And Owen would say, it's sinful that you're even able to entertain the thought. But if you continue to entertain it instead of shutting off the temptation, then God is not pleased with that. In other words, there's a difference between the thought occurring to you, which is still sinful, and then you entertaining the thought and fantasizing about it and going along. And he was just trying to say, it's a way of not keeping people too discouraged by the very fact that they're having the temptations. And if you just say, well, there's no difference between resisting them and giving into them, it's just as bad to be tempted as to actually entertain the thought, then you give them nothing to shoot for. That's almost like almost nobody can stop that at that right. certain point. So anyway, Owen's just trying to say, find a way of encouraging at the same time, letting people know that this is all still sinful. All that's happening is sinful, but it doesn't mean that you can't please God even in the struggle. So we've right. said that before. go ahead. Sorry.
Statement 7, sanctification. We affirm that Christians should flee immoral behavior and not yield to temptation. By the power of the Holy Spirit working through the ordinary means of grace, Christians should seek to wither, weaken, and put to death the underlying idolatries and sinful desires that lead to sinful behavior. The goal is not just consistent fleeing from and regular resistance to temptation, but the diminishment and even the end of the occurrence of sinful desires through the reordering of the loves of one's heart toward Christ. Through the virtue of Christ's death and resurrection, we can make substantial progress in the practice of true holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. So emphasis there, we can make progress by the Spirit. Nevertheless, this process of sanctification, even when the Christian is diligent and fervent in the application of the means of grace, will always be accompanied by many weaknesses and imperfections. That's what our confession says, with the Spirit and the flesh warring against one another until final glorification. The believer who struggles with same-sex attraction should expect to see the regenerate nature increasingly overcome the remaining corruption of the flesh. But this progress will often be slow and uneven. Moreover, the process of mortification, vivification involves the whole person, not simply unwanted sexual desires. The aim of sanctification in one's sexual life cannot be reduced to attraction to persons of the opposite sex, though some persons may experience movement in this direction, but rather involves growing in grace and perfecting holiness in the fear of God. I think what we're trying to do as a committee there, you know, there's that old Bob Newhart sketch. He's the counselor and he just keeps saying, just stop it. Just stop it. So we're trying to avoid any sort of counsel that sounds like, just be better. Stop doing those things. If you just read your Bible and went to church and prayed a little bit more, you wouldn't have these same-sex attractions. Just, why are you still doing this? Why are you still feeling this way? That's not biblical and that's not loving. At the same time, some people, because maybe they've received that bad sort of counsel or seen it in practice, then go to the another extreme and act as if, you know, these desires, same-sex attraction is in a different category from other sorts of sins. And they cannot be mortified. They cannot be changed. We should not expect any sort of growth. So we're trying to give the right confessional language, uneven, back and forth, warring against the flesh. But at the same time, we should expect, by the diligent use of the ordinary means of grace, to see substantial progress, not just on this issue, but in any sin in our life. That's the power of the Spirit. Greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world. Ready for the next one, Tim?
Yeah.
I'm sure Brian is not happy with our length, but
well,
when he assigns all these preachers.
I know.
All right, we'll try it. Statement 8, impeccability. We affirm the impeccability of Christ. The incarnate Son of God neither sinned in thought, word, deed, or desire, nor had the possibility of sinning. Christ experienced temptation passively in the form of trials and the devil's entreaties, not actively in the form of disordered desires. Christ, this is just from Owen, had only the suffering part of temptation, where we also have the sinning part. Christ had no inward disposition or inclination unto the least evil, being perfect in all graces and all their operations at all times. So we're trying to avoid, sometimes we can clumsily say, well, Christ was tempted in every way. And then we map onto Christ our experience of temptation when that is dangerous. Nevertheless, Christ endured from without real soul-wrenching temptations. So we don't want to make them not real temptations, which qualified him to be our sympathetic high priest. Christ assumed a human nature that was susceptible to suffering and death. He was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Ready for statement 9?
Yeah, there's not much. The reason we've brought that up is because there are people who are saying that Jesus Christ had all the same temptations that we do. He was sexually tempted. And they wrongly infer from he was tempted in every way as we, that actually means he actually experienced the same psychological desires and things like that. And this is just our way of saying, no, you really can't go there. It's not a major point, but we felt like we needed to speak to it. So.
Statement 9, identity. We affirm that the believer's most important identity is found in Christ. Christians ought to understand themselves, define themselves, and describe themselves in light of their union with Christ, and their identity as regenerate, justified, holy children of God. To juxtapose identities rooted in sinful desires alongside the term Christian is inconsistent with biblical language and undermines the spiritual reality that we are new creations in Christ. Nevertheless, Being honest about our sin struggles is important. While Christians should not identify with their sin so as to embrace it or seek to base their identity on it, Christians ought to acknowledge their sin in an effort to overcome it. There's a difference between speaking about a phenomenological facet of a person's sin-stained reality and employing the language of sinful desires as a personal identity marker. That is, we name our sins, but we are not named by them. Moreover, we recognize that there are some secondary identities, when not rooted in sinful desires or struggles against the flesh, that can be legitimately affirmed along with our primary identity as Christians. For example, the distinctions between male and female or between various nationalities and people groups are not eradicated in becoming Christians, but serve to magnify the glory of God in his plan of salvation. Statement 10, then. We affirm that those in our churches would be wise to avoid the term gay Christian. Though the term gay may refer to more than being attracted to persons of the same sex, the term does not communicate less than that. For many people in our culture, to self-identify as gay suggests that one is engaged in homosexual practice. At the very least, the term normally communicates the presence and approval of same-sex sexual attraction as morally neutral or morally praiseworthy. Even if gay for some Christians simply means same-sex attraction, it is still inappropriate to juxtapose this sinful desire or any other sinful desire as an identity marker alongside our identity as new creations in Christ. Nevertheless, we recognize that some Christians may use the term gay in an effort to be more readily understood by non-Christians. The word gay is common in our culture, and we do not think it wise for churches to police every use of the term. Our burden is that we do not justify our sin struggles by affixing them to our identity as Christians. Churches should be gentle, patient, and intentional with believers who call themselves gay Christians, encouraging them as part of the process of sanctification to leave behind identification language rooted in sinful desires, to live chaste lives, to refrain from entering into temptation, and to mortify their sinful desires. So Tim, just to state the obvious, these two statements, 9 and 10, are very debated in the PCA, and I hope that the committee, we felt like we worded things in a way that was faithful to the scriptures and to our confession and still took into account the variations of just human language. So on the one hand, we're, that language about policing, we don't want to turn this into a shibboleth, like the people crossing the river there and Judges, and they have to say the right word, and that we're always just looking to nail people. And on the other hand, there is really a significant issue here. If we juxtapose sinful desires with the identity of Christian. And so the language really does matter. We're trying to have a measure of human understanding in how language can change and evolve, but yet the underlying issues at stake here are significant. And I think the statements 9 and 10 do try to address them with some theological wisdom.
I don't have much to add. I mean, all seven members of the committee agreed. And that first part of statement 10 is pretty strong. It's really saying, pastorally, we really strongly advise against calling yourself a gay Christian. But the nevertheless is trying to get across the fact that you're going beyond the confession and probably the Bible to create, take a word, an English word, and then say, we're going to discipline you over that, by use of that. We're trying to say people use these words differently. Their intentions are different. And therefore, what we really ought to do is we ought to use pastoral, use our pastoral tools to try to work with people rather than simply say, we can, on the basis of the confession, the basis of the Bible, we can tell you, you're sinning by using that word. We said, we can't go that far. Some people would want to do that. And this is one of the things that will probably be debated. But I really think that statement 9 and 10 hit that balance pretty well, because it's really pretty unmistakable. As a denomination, if you adopt this, what we're saying is, no, this is not the, this is, pastorally, we are really advising against that. So anyway.
Statement 11, we affirm that our contemporary ecclesiastical culture has an underdeveloped understanding of friendship and often does not honor singleness as it should. The church must work to see that all members, including believers who struggle with same-sex attraction, are valued members of the body of Christ and engaged in meaningful relationships through the blessings of the family of God. Likewise, we affirm the value of Christians who share common struggles, gathering together for mutual accountability, exhortation, and encouragement. Nevertheless, we do not support the formation of exclusive contractual marriage-like friendships, nor do we support same-sex romantic behavior or the assumption that certain sensibilities and interests are necessarily aspects of a gay identity. We do not consider same-sex attraction a gift in itself, nor do we think this sin struggle or any sin struggle should be celebrated in the church. I think, Tim, you alluded at the beginning, one statement that it's not that we reversed the order of affirm and nevertheless, but we did reverse in that the affirmation here is sort of the use the language, the positive pastoral side, encouraging friendship, the necessity of friendship, even acknowledging the underdeveloped nature of friendship in some of our churches. But the nevertheless is really important because it's putting on the necessary theological guardrails. Well, here's what we mean and don't mean by this kinds of friendship. And I think it's really important that that last line, that while there can be unique relationships that have mutual accountability around same-sex attraction, and while there, we've already said it may elicit a certain kind of compassion for this particular sin struggle, we aren't looking toward this sin struggle or any sin struggle and to celebrate it and to say what a gift it is that I have this particular sin struggle in my life. We wouldn't say that with any sin struggle. So yes, sympathy toward those who feel beset by this, and yet we're not advocating a kind of friendship that would be around the mutual celebration of it. Anything else, Tim, before we read the last one? All right. You've all been patient here. Statement 12, repentance and hope. We affirm that the entire life of the believer is one of repentance. That from Luther's famous 95 Theses, where we have mistreated those who struggle with same-sex attraction or with any other sinful desires, we call ourselves to repentance. Where we have nurtured or made peace with sinful thoughts, desires, words, or deeds, we call ourselves to repentance. Where we have heaped upon others misplaced shame or have not dealt well with necessary God-given shame, we call ourselves to repentance. There in that first paragraph, we're not saying we infallibly know what's happening in all of our churches, but wherever these things are happening, we want to repent of them. Nevertheless, here we try to end on a note of hopefulness. We call ourselves to the evangelical grace of repentance. We see, as we call ourselves to that, we see many reasons for rejoicing. We give thanks for penitent believers who, though they continue to struggle with same-sex attraction, are living lives of chastity and obedience. These brothers and sisters can serve as courageous examples of faith and faithfulness as they pursue Christ with a long obedience in gospel dependence. We also give thanks for ministries and churches within our denomination that minister to sexual strugglers of all kinds with biblical truth and grace. Most importantly, we give thanks for the gospel that can save and transform the worst of sinners, older brothers and younger brothers, tax collectors and Pharisees, insiders and outsiders. We rejoice in 10,000 spiritual blessings that are ours when we turn from sin by the power of the Spirit, trust in the promises of God, and rest upon Christ alone for justification, sanctification, and eternal life. I'd be quite content to perhaps give that the final word, but I'll turn it to Tim if you have any comment to make on this very last statement.
No, I'm also content to make that the final word.
So just want to reiterate again, it really was a lot of hard work and an unexpected joy to serve on this committee. And thank you in particular, Tim. We did a lot of work together and then the whole group with us, but joy to work with you. And at the very beginning in the preamble, it said these 12 statements in particular, we wanted to be for wide distribution right in the church, knowing that the whole report is important, but it's difficult to read 50, 60, 70 pages and get sessions or Sunday school classes. But we really hope that these 12 statements, you could do a 12-week Sunday school class on each one, or you could read through it in a session meeting, or you could do a one-off adult class walking through. It takes just 20 minutes to read through it. And we think there's a lot of really significant theological pastoral wisdom, we hope, there. So thank you, Tim, and thank you, Brian, for leading us, and to the General Assembly for bearing with us as we read and talk via the dreaded Zoom.
Right.
God bless.